I want to tell Jake that unfortunately I don't think our ABC is any better than the BBC, actually.
Can we have a bit of hush for the questioner, please?
I also think it ought to be pointed out that the clown act that Netanyahu just performed has a precedent. It happened before the Iraq war when he addressed the Congress and urged that we go to war against Iraq. And we know what happened out of that.
So the question, Alice?
So my question, however, is I maybe because I'm Jewish and people regard me as a Jewish anti-Semite because I worry about Palestinian rights, I get a whole lot of emails pointing out the anti-Semitism in the Labour Party, which Corbyn is not cleaning up. Is there any truth in that? Because I've actually seen some broadcasts that seem to show it. And if so, what about the Conservative Party? Maybe that has just as many anti-Semites. Maybe it's just happening. So can you comment on that, please?
There's an anti-Semitic fringe in Labour. There's a larger category of almost monumental stupidity in Labour. For example, the council candidate in Northamptonshire who thought it was a good idea to link from his Facebook page to a Holocaust denial site to see what the reaction would be. The woman who was appointed by the party to look into such cases, who immediately took to social media to defend this guy, in spite of her quasi-judicial role, these are acts of either deliberate sabotage or, much more likely, monumental stupidity. Having said that, there is only one mainstream political party that routinely has recourse to racism as a campaigning tool and a means of controlling the political agenda, and that's the Conservative Party. And there's a disgraceful lineage going at least back to the infamous 1964 Smethwick by-election, when the Tory slogan was, "If you want a nigger for your neighbour, vote Labour." Margaret Thatcher told a World in Action interviewer in 1978 that she sympathised with people who felt that Britain was being swamped by people with an alien culture. A couple of years ago, the Tory party hired Linton Crosby, late of this parish, to mastermind the most disgraceful race-baiting campaign in the London mayoral election, smearing the Labour candidate Sadiq Khan as a terrorist sympathiser. So these are all means of igniting what the political scientist Murray Edelman called a political spectacle, to personify a threat in order to get people to overlook issues of, in this case, social justice, in order to get them to vote Conservative instead. And the systematic use of racism by the Conservative Party is in an entirely different league from the fringe anti-Semitism of Labour.
Thank you very much. Politically, Margaret Thatcher was famously recorded as saying that her greatest success in politics was Tony Blair, having her alternate opposition accept her ideology. Does Jeremy Corbyn represent a paradigm shift? And how will that play out in terms of maybe affecting the Australian Labor Party? Is there any hope there? In addition, is the harassment and vilification and attempts at delegitimisation of Labor leader Jeremy Corbyn synonymous with the fact that 70% of Britain's newspapers are owned by just three companies, Rupert Murdoch's News UK, the Daily Mirror's General Trust and Trinity Mirror, and that a broadcast media of over 80% of the national audience goes to Murdoch or an increasingly biased BBC, a concentration of media ownership which for a tiny clique in Britain allows them to effectively control the flow of information to over 65 million people along the lines of Noam Chomsky's manufacturing consent in order to subvert the democratic will and protect their privileged material class interests.
That's it, Kieran, I think. Okay. We've got the question. It's a good question.
But does social media change that whole dynamic, is what I'm saying.
Well done, Kieran, thank you. I mean, the answer to the first one, I think, is very clearly that there has been a paradigm shift because the paradigm is bust, is broke. It hasn't bust in Australia because Australia's not been affected by global financial crisis and recession to the same degree as Europe has and North America has, and these countries are really hurting. So the problem in for the Labour Party in Britain is that nearly all of the MPs came up and cut their teeth during the Blair period. And this is what's created that sense of dissonance within the party and why the parliamentary party is really Corbyn's main problem and why at the local level there is therefore a push to deselect right-wing Labour MPs because they're no longer in tune with what the leadership wants to do or indeed what the membership wants to do. So this is why you've got this very kind of interesting dynamic at the moment in the Labour Party. But Corbyn completely rejects the inheritance of neoliberal globalisation. He is very keen to get past the austerity kind of measures and that whole kind of mindset of cuts in order to sort of reflate the public finances and so on. And so if he's... And if he's elected, he will do that. That's the other thing that people quite understand. I mean, on the media, here's my take. I don't know if Jake mentioned it before I came in here. There's quite a famous novel called A Very British Coup by Chris Mullin. I don't know if Jake mentioned it. But if you read that, I've been reading it on holiday last week. 1982 it was written. The scenario is basically a far left, radical left prime minister of Labour is elected. How does the establishment react? And when you read this novel, it is almost exactly the things that we're describing now. Smear campaigns, all sorts of scare issues, the anti-Semitism thing. I was a member of the Labour Party in England for 20 years. I can honestly say I never heard a word of anything anti-Semitic, anything racist. There was lots and lots of other things that people used to get very het up about, stupid things were said, but not at all on the issue of race or equality or the basic rights that all of us as citizens deserve. But in A Very British Coup, I mean, what you've got to see now, the Financial Times has blown the bugle. The ruling class is worried in Britain. They are going to throw a lot of money at making sure that every single avenue is explored to dethrone and delegitimate Jeremy Corbyn. He knows that. That's why they're preparing via social media. That's why they're mobilizing young people. That's why they're concentrating their resources in a very strategic way, because the onslaught has only just started. And it's going to get much messier and much bloodier as we come into 2019 and a possible general election. The ruling class plus governing class, they are running scared. They really are going to pull out all the stops. So this is just the start. The anti-Semite thing, just the start. You haven't seen anything yet.
I'm going to take two questions at a time now because I know there's a film to follow tonight's event. Brian, you've got the microphone.
Yeah, g'day, Brian Concannon. My question's about what's happening in... I had a mind blank.
Just what's happening.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah. Well, you got... Theresa May, Trump, and Macron all hitting Syria with missiles without a legitimate proof. Like they jumped to conclusions before any OPCW inspection, which Jeremy Corbyn actually accused Theresa May of. Like, what the hell are you doing? Attacking, risking World War III without adequate proof. The same was done with the Cypriot. Russia kept demanding, give us the proof, give us the proof. Theresa May couldn't bring the proof. My question is, is there a new policy of the West that guilty until proven innocent? Like, it's like, what's going on? What's the change? Like, there's no proof needed these days. They just attack countries, kill innocents without any adequate proof. What the fuck?
Hi there. My question is for Jake as well as Simon. It's basically, what parallels do you see between the behaviour and practices of the media in Britain versus the media in Australia?
It is a policy of guilty until proven innocent, but it's not new. As far as the prospect of an investigation by a competent authority is concerned, it's a very closely akin to what we used to say sometimes as political reporters. Fuck no, don't check it. It might be wrong. There was a category of story that was too good to check, and the story that Syria has carried out a chemical attack in Douma was obviously too good to check. My old colleague from The Independent, Robert Fisk, did file a very interesting eyewitness report he found people on the ground bemused by the claim that this was a chemical attack, and much more likely, in fact, that the symptoms treated by the hospital and then retailed by the International Committee of the Red Cross were attributable to hypoxia from a dust storm blown into the tunnels that people have had to dig for themselves in order to survive the bombardment overhead. So, yeah, it could very well be that, you know, without that due process, it will feed into the kind of cycles of injustice that are already perpetuating the conflict. As far as Australian media is concerned, it's a very similar system, ostensibly a system of liberal media. There are nuances of difference, probably in Australia's favour, if anything. I mean, for example, a few years ago, the BBC in its Panorama strand broadcast a disgraceful film called Death on the Med. And it was about the attack on the Mavi Marmara aid vessel that was taking supplies to Gaza from Turkey, in which 11 aid workers were shot dead by Israeli commandos. And this particular BBC film used unattributed, doctored footage supplied by the Israeli Defense Force without even alerting the viewer to it. And it was then, the same film was then broadcast here on the Foreign Correspondent strand. And the same, very similar complaints went in both to the BBC Trust, which had responsibility for complaints about the BBC at the time, and to the ABC's Complaints Review Executive. And the finding from the BBC was nothing to worry about, whereas the finding from the ABC was, yes, this is wrong, this should never have been broadcast. So there's a nuance of difference, probably in Australia's favour.
A few years ago, when Jeremy Corbyn started becoming more mainstream, a person called Bernie Sanders in America started to, in a similar sort of path, act as a parallel and filling the void in the West that's actually lost its ways. So firstly, even though Bernie Sanders had a lot of similarities with Jeremy Corbyn, he was finally garrotted in the end in terms of politically, and that created a void that actually in America they lost their way and went on the side of Trump. Did Bernie Sanders aid or hinder Jeremy Corbyn's plight from the other side of the Atlantic? And secondly, in terms of what you said earlier about the governing class are scared, what would it look like if they were to truly sort of see the end results of Jeremy Corbyn winning and actually putting his ideas into practice? What would it look like? Thank you.
Yeah, thanks to the speakers. I wanted to raise the question of one of the key policies of Jeremy Corbyn, which is the renationalisation of the railways, and I think extended to other areas that have been decimated by years of Tory government. And I wanted to put forward the thesis, perhaps, if we want to make a comparison with Australia, that our Blair government was the Hawke Keating government, and we got all this some years ago, including the biggest crime that they did was to sell off the Commonwealth Bank. And I want to raise the question here that we should be talking about, along with Jeremy Corbyn talking about renationalised, we should be nationalising the banks. I don't know how many people here also had their accounts fall off the back of a truck in the last couple of years, which I probably did too. But okay, I'll leave it there. Would you like to comment on the question of the renationalisation or nationalisation as an important program?
Sure. So, public transport as well. So the Bernie Saunders point is a really good one, I think. Saunders, a very, very smart politician, very authentic as well, and a self-proclaimed socialist. So he should have won, absolutely. And if he had got that nomination, actually, there's quite a few US political scientists out there who would speculate that he would have won overall. Why? Because the swing states is Rust Belt America. California always votes the same way, New York always votes the same way, Texas usually votes the same way. But when you look at Wisconsin and Idaho and these swing states, actually Saunders really spoke very much to the heart of the issue there, which was how to get investment, how to get jobs back, how to make America, in a sense, a country of ordinary people, not for the 1%. And he was resonating in those. So he was done over by the Democratic Party. This is why the Corbyn thing is kind of widely reported, is what's been going on is the mobilization of young people, the inflation of the Labour Party. So that Labour Party figure, 200,000 people when Corbyn came to power, now 650,000 members. What do you think those 400,000 new members want to see, right? They want to see real action, right? They're Corbynites. So he has squeezed his own party, which means it's very, very uncomfortable now for the centre-right in his own party. The problem for Saunders is that that's not how the Democrat Party works in the US. It's 52 separate parties. There is no national party. So it's very, very difficult for a radical left senator or representative to break through into that space. But Saunders is not done yet. He does senior citizens a great... I mean, these are... Jeremy Corbyn, 68. Saunders is, I think, 73 or 74. And they're both saying, we're good for another 10. Yeah? You haven't seen anything yet, right? I mean, good on them. That's what I say. Right. So the other, I mean, the other thing about... what was the second half of the question? Because there was a... So what's going to happen if he comes into power? Read the novel, A Very British Coup. Because what happens in that, and this is the thing to think about, is that is the run on the banks, okay? So, you know, Corbyn might say, well, what we need to do is to renationalize and to take ourselves away from international finance markets. But of course, that's not how markets behave. And one of the things they do is capital flight is a real risk for any left regime. We've seen it over and over again in Argentina, Spain, Portugal today. Britain would be the same. It's capital flight. Big business organizes itself, disinvest, takes its money out of the stock market. There's a run on the pound. This is what happens in the novel. And before you know it, people are screaming blue murder because there's no money coming into the exchequer. There's no money to pay the public sector workers, and you get a squeeze on. And the denouement of a very British coup has been, I think, studied by contemporary Labour figures over and over again. And it's well worth reading because this is the problem with transnational capital, that they gang up. Yeah, the bankers, finance, the 1%, they know how this game works. They gang up to beat up radical left-wing regimes around the world, whether it be in Australia or Britain or anything. You've got to deal with the banks. And that's the great takeaway from the novel, and I think it's the great takeaway for Corbyn. Will it change his mind? Will it dissuade him from doing the things that he wants to? Not for a minute. That's why people like him. He's not the kind of guy, oh, crikey, you know, there are some bankers who are telling us that we can't do what we want to do. In a democracy, you follow the program. You follow the manifesto. Might hurt, might be a pinch, but, you know, that's how it works. That's how democracies are supposed to work.
I'm speaking to the issue of trade unions. Bit of background. You had your Arthur Scargill years, Margaret Thatcher years, and we had our Malcolm Fraser years and Bob Hawke years, where, you know, the general populace, the working class, were sold down the drain by our accord. My question is, has the advent of Corbyn led to ructions within the union movement? And are there a higher calibre of leaders on the way because of it?
Thank you for that. That was excellent. I grew up in Britain and I'm very interested in the media here. Now, I think you're right about social media. That's a great way to go, and I think we should support the media that support us. But personally, I haven't seen anything like what the ABC is doing, which is completely dropping reporting of 1,500 people held hostage on Manus in Nauru. Unbelievable. What I'm doing, I'd like others to think about doing it, is ring up the bloody ABC, talk to Mark Maley, who's the editor of... manager of editorial policy of the news, and tell him what you think. He talks over you, but he's rattled by it. If you tackle them, do all these things, develop our own media, yeah, but tackle these bastards who have dropped these 1,500 people on Manus and Nauru, plus all the rest of them in the gulag in Australia, plus all the people on terrible visas. It goes on and on, but this is something incredible, I think, and we must take action. Thank you.
Just on the media question, I'm definitely in sympathy with the question. I mean, one sort of besetting weakness of Australian media representations, which could actually be remedied, it is within reach of journalists to remedy it, is the rarity with which Australian audiences actually get to, as it were, meet an asylum seeker or refugee. You know, I mean, political responses to asylum seekers were in the news throughout my period as a political correspondent, for example. And we used to contact asylum seekers through things like the Medical Centre for the Care of Victims of Torture in London. And we used to have them into the studio now and again. You know, and it was a bit easier there because they weren't all locked up. But there are people who've been through the system who bravely speak out they occasionally crop up on SBS, so there's not really any excuse for other media not to do it. I just add, I haven't read the column in the Financial Times to which Simon refers. I'll make a guess that one of the factors in their calculus is that when an election campaign actually gets underway, there is a whole swath of further obligations that come into force on all public service broadcasters, not just public broadcasters, but also commercial ones, which have the same public service obligations, namely the Representation of the People Act. And Corbyn and the people around Corbyn almost heaved a sigh of relief when that kicked in during the election campaign in 2017, because that does actually confer obligations to ensure that there is a numerical parity of the number of minutes devoted to the main speakers from the main political parties, which is a breach from the normal pattern of ignoring or marginalising Corbyn's views. So that's also an important factor, I think.
I'd like to take the Brits on the panel and in the audience and everybody else back into the dark ages of British history. 80 years ago, 1945, Clement Attlee got elected Prime Minister. The Attlee government was there for 6 years, and they did a heap of reforms which took the British ruling class more than half a century to undo. So you can expect Corbyn to do the same thing when he becomes Prime Minister. Just a quick rundown of what they did. The Law Reform Act, the Housing Act, Coal Industry Nationalisation Act, Rent Control Act, National Health Service Act, National Insurance Act, New Towns, it goes on. Pensions Act, Superannuation Act, Transport Act. So we can expect, well, let's hope that Corbyn redoes all that and goes even further and undoes all of these so-called reforms that the ruling class has done since then.
Now, the Queen attended Margaret Thatcher's funeral saying, "Margaret made Britain great again." I believe that was a royal error and a half. Now, the way I remember Margaret Thatcher, although I've never been to Britain, I only heard about the place from people who lived there, one man told me that the water utilities had been nationalised. When somebody could not pay his or her rates, or whatever you call the charges, the water was turned off. So all of a sudden, people could not flush their toilets. So what they did, they went back to the Middle Ages and started using chamber pots, which they emptied out into the street in the middle of the night. So Margaret Thatcher has turned the calendar back centuries. That is very shameful. Apart from that, she has also persecuted the poor, causing many of them to die in the streets of exposure. Now, I'd just like to know, in Britain, are there any tollways?
Are there any tollways?
One or two. Perhaps I could throw in a little anecdote. I was at a Labour Party conference 18 months before a momentous general election, and the Labour leader said, under a Labour government, there will be a publicly owned, publicly accountable railway system. The year was 1995, and the leader was Tony Blair. Now, I was a reporter in the northeast of England when Blair was Shadow Home Secretary, and a local MP, the rising star, and an auspicious occasion in his constituency was when the town of Newton Aycliffe was anointed as the venue for a new factory to be opened by the Japanese high-tech company Fujitsu. And this was held to be, you know, the future of manufacturing for the northeast region. And Tony Blair was in attendance, shaking hands, beaming that distinctive Cheshire cat smile. A few years later, Fujitsu upped and announced that the factory was to close. By now, Blair's Prime Minister, still the local MP. So Blair turns up. As a meeting of worried and angry workers in this kind of big room, and all the cameras there, Blair comes in, sort of issues a few bromides, how they've all done very well. Any questions? And one of them says, "So are you going to keep our factory, Mr. Blair, or what?" And he says, "Well, I can't change the way the market works," he said. And you could just see a kind of cloud forming above the heads of these guys, hovering there with the thought, "What's the bloody point of having you then?" Because if your Labour government doesn't propose to change a market as outrageously rigged in favour of capital and against workers as the market in Britain for inward investment, what is the point of having it? So that has been a kind of repressed term of inherent and, if you like, inchoate support for the Labour cause in Britain for many, many years, which has been neglected and marginalised. And now it's come roaring back under Jeremy Corbyn, and many, many people who were turned off from politics altogether in the new Labour era would be among the extra 450,000 people, no doubt, who've joined the party. And that's a very important source of that political energy. It's been pent up. Perhaps it's been pent up since 1945, but it's certainly been pent up since the new Labour era.
Okay, Cathy, you want to make an announcement?
Oh, not yet. No.
Okay. Look, I've just got a couple of brief commercials to end the evening with before I thank the two speakers on your behalf. I've now got three, but as I haven't got my glasses, I can't read them anyway. The first commercial is about the Green Hand Band, which is supporting refugee and migrant initiatives and will be performing from 4 to 9 this Saturday at the street food markets in Addison Road, Marrickville. And the next commercial, which I've just had, is called The Happening Weekly Refugee Protest at, can you tell me what the date is, Jake? You haven't got your glasses, are they?
It's every Friday, 6 p.m. at the statue outside the QVB.
Okay. The Queen Victoria statue. May Day Rally, which is a week, almost a week late, Sunday the 8th of, the 6th of May rather, Hyde Park North, starting at 11 a.m. Most importantly, the two commercials concern the programme for Politics in the Pub. We were to have had Justice Kirby speaking about North Korea next week, but he's been called away to India to preside over a discussion about the benefits of the Indian caste system or something like that. So instead, our wonderful colleague, Professor Frank Stilwell, is going to do an impromptu analysis of ScoMo's budget. So the budget is on Tuesday, and the real analysis that will be worth listening to across Australia will occur here starting at 6:15, at 6:30, this coming Thursday, okay? Now, and the first topic of the new quarter is, I think, very important, which is in 2 weeks' time. It's about Israel's Gaza slaughter and the West's moral bankruptcy. We thought on the planning committee that we ought, given that there's been a deafening silence from politicians, particularly in Canberra, certainly from the major parties, and I imagine too across Britain, too, I haven't heard anything said about it, as though the Israelis have a blank check to continue to do what they like. So those are two important topics. Now it's my pleasure to on your behalf, say we've had two very substantial presentations tonight. Yeah. The size of the audience.